In this video, we'll discuss the capital asset pricing model. Under the capital asset pricing model, the rate of return of a security is the risk-free rate plus the market risk premium, which is the difference between the rate of return of the market and the risk-free rate, times beta, where beta is a risk measurement of the riskiness of your security relative to the market, as opposed to standard deviation, which is the measurement of the riskiness of your security by itself. Beta can be measured as the covariance of the rate of return of your stock with respect to the market divided by the variance of the market. Beta equals zero would be a risk-free investment, commonly considered the U.S. government treasury bill. Another possible proxy would just be the rate of return of a government-guaranteed bank account. A beta of 1 is an average risk security. If you stick 1 into this equation, the risk-free rates cancel out, and you end up with the rate of return of your security is that of the market. Common proxies for the market are broad market indices such as the S&P 500 or the Wilshire 5000. A beta greater than 1 is an above-average risk stock, like a tech stock. A beta less than 1 is a below-average risk stock, like a public utility. Public utilities are generally government-regulated. Pretty much everyone has to buy electricity. If there's a possibility of the electric company losing money, a board allows them to increase rates. A rare circumstance where they might lose money would be during partial deregulation in California, where retail electricity rates were price controlled, but wholesale rates were allowed to fluctuate. Wholesale rates at one point went above retail rates. It is possible to have a beta less than zero or a negative beta instrument. In some cases, oil or gold might be like this. When oil prices go up, stock prices go down. When gold prices go up, also it's possible stock prices might go down. A way of looking at a negative beta instrument would be an insurance product. When you invest in car insurance, you expect to lose money, but it lowers the investment of the portfolio of your car plus the insurance. As a sample calculation, consider a risk-free rate of 3%, a market rate of return of 12%, and an above-average risk stock of 1.2. Under those circumstances, you end up from the equation of a rate of return of your security of 13.8. Since it is above-risk security, you would expect it to have a risk greater than the market, which it does. If you were to use CAPM as a vehicle to determine what stocks are good to invest in, you might look at a graph like this. We show systematic risk, which is beta, the risk relative to the market, on the x-axis, and rate of returns on the y-axis. The blue line is the capital asset pricing model line for stocks in equilibrium, determined by this equation. But it's possible that stocks are not always in equilibrium. Let's say expected RI, or the expected rate of return of a stock, is going to be above the capital asset pricing model line, then these stocks would be considered good buys. Everyone would buy them. The P-naught in this equation would go up. The expected rate of return would go down. And then the rate of return of these stocks would drop to the capital asset pricing model line. Stocks down here with a rate of return below the CAPM line would be considered bad investments. You would want to either sell them or short sell them. And if you did that, then the P-naught here would go down, then the expected rate of return would go up, and again, these stocks' rate of return would go back to the CAPM line. So if everybody followed this model, in time, all of the stocks would be explained by CAPM, or they would all be in so-called equilibrium, as shown by this equation. The CAPM equation can also be arranged to solve for other variables. Here, for example, we rearrange the CAPM equation and solve for beta. Getting beta is KS minus K risk free divided by K market minus K risk-free. You could also solve for KM, KS minus K risk-free over beta plus K risk-free, or you could solve for the risk-free rate itself, which would be KS minus KM times beta over 1 minus beta. For this example, consider KS is 13%, K market is 15, beta is 0.8. We stick these numbers into this equation, and we get, under those circumstances, the risk-free rate is 5%. I thank you for watching this video.